Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, for this panel discussion on winning strategies for the new normal. I have with me some of the really best and sharpest minds in this industry, Vibha Padalkar, MD and CEO, HDFC Life, G. Muralidhar, MD and CEO, Kotak Life Insurance, Shitij Jain, MD and CEO, Exide Life Insurance, and Kamlesh Rao, MD and CEO of Aditya Birla Sun Life Insurance. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for taking the time out from your busy schedules to be with us today. So new normal, what is my understanding of new normal? One is this whole march towards digital, which every single industry is going through, which looks like an irreversible move in some sense. And the second part is really the investment regime. By investment regime, I'm talking about the low interest rates across the world and also in India. We can, of course, debate whether it's going to be continuing like this over the medium term or not. But we'll come to that a little later. First off the bat, we'll dive into the digital part of it, going digital in the post-COVID era. And gentlemen and Vibha, I would like to understand from you, where is life insurance industry really on the digitization curve? And what are some of the challenges and opportunities in digital delivery, fulfillment, and everything in terms of enablement and serving customers? Where are we on that curve? And what are some of the challenges and opportunities? May I start with Vibha?
Yes, thank you, Mahalakshmi, for having us and also patiently getting all of us together. We are actually at a very interesting phase of our digital journey collectively as an industry. And also it's again and again reinforces the eye towards the future, because buying patterns, why only of millennials, but even during the pandemic, what India has seen as to how very quickly we moved to buying our provisions online and through perhaps people for the first time having downloaded apps to do so. And suddenly realize that the journey isn't as complex as it was made out to be. So we are at that inflection point. We need to do as much as we can do within extant data protection, within extant regulations, and so on. But if we don't start now, or if we haven't already embarked upon the journey, I think we will just be doing more of the earlier model that we have been used to doing. And they will coexist, I think, over the at least the medium term, the old way of selling insurance and servicing customers and the new way of doing it. And there will be this migration from old to new and all the pains and the joys that come with such a migration. But I think there is nothing today, which is what I think my colleagues on this panel will also agree, there is nothing today that cannot be sold or serviced through end-to-end digital. It exists today. And it's a question of if the customer is willing, then we have the tools. If the partner is willing, then we have the tools. And we can build from here on the basis of how do we also mine big data? How do we give dynamic underwriting? How do we effectively use AI ML? How do we effectively use bots to take over at least some of the basics? How do we create early warning indicators, whether it's in risk management of fraudulent claims or in mis-selling complaints and so on. So it's really all-encompassing, and tech has started, if not already, to be core as against to be gratuitous. So I'm very, very not just optimistic, but I see no other way but for us to also go digital native in a lot of our offerings that we're thinking about.
Sure. Kamlesh, you have straddled many industries within the financial services space. You were in broking earlier. Where do you think life insurance is on that whole digitization curve? And what are some of the challenges and the opportunities that you would define taking cues from other industries?
No, I think on a comparative frame, when you look at Mahalakshmi, if you go back to broking or you go back to what's happening in payment on the banking side, I wouldn't, resist to admit that between digital enablement and digital consumption of direct customer, I think there is a big difference. I think the digital consumption of products by customers directly in the banking space on payments or on broking is significantly ahead of the curve as far as digital is concerned. We must thank COVID, and I'm not sounding fatalistic in this, but I think the entire digital enablement journey in life insurance must have got fast-paced, maybe multifold, thanks to COVID. And I think that's the big change that's happened in the life insurance industry, where we had no other option but to reach out, for distributors to reach out to their customers, whether it is distributors or our banker partners. But I think there's a lot of work to do. The digital in the true sense is not just about the enablement, but also the simplicity of our product. Unfortunately, I think life insurance has this baggage of saying that, you know, we have complicated products, and therefore some of the work that we need to do going forward, according to me, is apart from the enablement work that we are doing, can we also make our products simpler, which then again becomes amenable for consumption on the digital platform. Remember that every offtake in digital today is not just by the UI and UX of the platform that you create, but also the ease of your consumption process that you have. So I think whilst we are doing a lot of great work in the area of the UI, UX, and the digitization and enablement, I think there's work to do on the simplification of our products, which will, over a period of time, then make sure that the digital consumption will really kind of take off. And the most important worry in my mind, as I speak to you now, is post-COVID, and I don't know when that world is, maybe 6 months from now, how much of what we have learned to do in the last 6 or 7 months, we are able to preserve and conserve and combine that with the new normal, because undoubtedly this digital enablement has brought a lot of benefits to the life insurance industry on productivity and OPEX and so on and so forth. So I think we've got to learn to how to do, it should not be an either or kind of a principle, because life insurance is otherwise seen as a relationship based kind of sale. I think we'll have to imbibe the old and the new together in the post-COVID world. So that's something that I would watch out for sure.
Sure. So you brought up the point on product simplification, which I will come to. But before that, from a business perspective, Murali, for example, does digitization really alter? I mean, what are the cost benefits really like? And do you see accelerated pace for digitization over the next 3 years? And in what direction? What can one expect will happen, and what will take time?
So I think digitization is not an either or of. It's I think it has to be done. I don't think there is any escape from it, because the biggest issue the insurance industry faces, I think, so long has always been that customer participation in the buying process. Probably the combination of reasons, because the product is complicated or not explained very well to him, or he has not made so much of it. But I think digitization actually gives us that opportunity to explain it in a much more simple and a standardized manner. And I think that's where we have seen changes. We have been able, thanks to COVID, thanks to social distancing, we are now sending standardized pitches, standardized benefit illustration. The benefit illustration is anyway standardized, but we are able to do that in such a manner. And also, since you have to explain to the customer the product, they are able to bring in more firepower, because formula is only the LA. Now, probably when complicating things have to be explained, the sales team can also join. So that is all possible to bring it together in one platform, which makes it simpler for the LA to sell their product and also learn in the process. So, and I think that's a big change. Because as a result, the customer participation improves. And we are able to do that, and we are very sure about what is being told to the customer. And now all insurers have done that. You know, everybody is doing this PCVC, or what we call as, as soon as you log in, you can talk all of the customer. And now we are able to do it on a video basis, so we're sure that the customer is actually understood. So the customer understanding is changing. The back office in IT, IT and digitization and all that modernization has always been there. But I think now we are also seeing a lot more underwriting, which was normally a back-end process, now because of decision actually taken up. The front-end sales guy sitting there is now possible for him to say, put in the data, he feeds in the data, it's possible to say, boss, this will go through, not go through, or these are the requirements. Otherwise, normally what will happen, you collect the data, comes back, some underwriter will sit on it and say, I need this more information. So those kind of stuff is possible and is being done. A lot of companies are there at various stages of development on this. Upfront telling you that probably you could up your insurance, you could do that better. So the selling process itself can be substantially important. But I think what is also going to happen going forward is that some of the companies have already done that and are in the process of doing it, including us, is that equip the front end much better, because today everybody, a lot of information about the customer is well known. Why does insurance have a problem? Because the number of people who can actually sell insurance to a customer are very limited. You don't know how to do that. But today, we are in a position to build a customer persona, tell whether it matches to the persona, and tell what you go and sell him. Someone comes and sells to me, he comes and sells to me probably an annuity. No point selling me insurance. And somebody younger, you go and sell insurance. And sell, you know? So it's all possible, which is to be taught to people initially in those days. Now it can actually be done on the fly, because somebody can actually prod him and guide him at that point of time, what is to be told. So I think relationship will be there, but it will coexist with a far more empowered front end. That's going to happen. And I hope that what COVID has done in the last 6 months made our agency learn fast. I hope it continues, and then they don't go back to their old practice of paper and all that. And I think analytics and all, which will become important, because now the luxury which you had that you have 10 leads and make one sale is gone. We have 10 leads, we actually have to make 4 or 5 sales, 6 sales, 7 sales. So that is only possible with better analytics, better arming the front end. So I think that's the direction it will take. The normal things like cutting the cost on better underwriting, better than that, is anyway will happen, and that will happen much faster.
In terms of cost benefits, do you really see digitization as something that can alter the profitability of companies in ways that, you know, does it make it costlier? Does it slash costs radically and change the equation, which you can redeploy in some other way?
Both will happen. Whatever costs which will, there will be cost saving on account of better automation and cutting down steps because of digitization, that will happen. We will also have to spend money in getting on the customer acquisition side through digitization, which has happened so well in most of the other industries. It's been pretty slow in life insurance. There it would mean that actually when you go to digital, you have to spend more money there. I think that was going to happen on that side. But efficiency and processes and thing will happen on this side. That's my view.
Sure. Kshitij, you want to come in on this? I mean, what is your view in terms of how does the complexion of a life insurance company really get altered, if at all, because of this whole march towards digitization? And then we could, of course, move on to the simplicity, which is...
So, it's always good to be able to come in last, because I have the benefit of the views of 3 speakers before me. So, first, I agree with everything that they said, you know, just to make sure that we are all on the same side. But, you know, my view, you know, as far as digitization
is concerned... All of you are on the same side and I'm on the other side. To realize.
I thought you were also on our side.
Yeah. So, you know, three things which come to mind as far as digitization is concerned. You know, we spoke about data, we spoke about AI, we talked about enabling the sales force, and we talked about operating efficiency. Okay. My sense is that if we need to see a fundamental change in expense efficiency, let's recognize 80% of the expenses in the life insurance industry are due with distribution. Okay. So the life insurance industry, I think, is reasonably efficient when it comes to managing policies, managing existing customers. The place where it has scope to make significant improvement is in cost of acquisition, or basically the large amount of money which is invested first in setting up an infrastructure for supporting distribution and then actually managing distribution itself. And the reason for that is we are fundamentally a business which is a hunting business. We are not a farming business. Okay. If you expect that with data, with digital, with automation, you will be able to start changing the complexion of a life insurer from being more farmer, less hunter. You will straight away start seeing benefits as far as cost of acquisition is concerned. So, you know, to add to what Murali said some time back, he said that earlier you could, you know, go out hunting. You sold one policy against 10 leads. Now, given the fact that it's not that easy to move around, customers are not that comfortable meeting you face to face as they were earlier, you know, you need to become so much more effective for every face to face or screen to screen interaction that you have. Okay. So my belief is that digital will have a profound impact on the industry in everything, pricing, product. But the largest impact that it will have is on distributor enablement. So the industry today has roughly 20 lakh agents, which represent it, which sell roughly 3.5 crore policies a year. Okay. So you can say in the next 3 to 5 years, there is every possibility that the number of distributors will come down, but the distributors who will be there will be far more efficient than they are today because they will be enabled by technology. So, and that I think could make a huge difference in making this career very attractive, and it could make a huge difference in the efficiencies of the industry. And then of course, there is the ability to be able to offer better pricing, better products, pass on the benefits of that efficiency to the customer, and of course, offer great customer service. The other big change which I see happening now is that in the past, in the industry, the customer relationship was by and large managed by the distributor and the company played the role of facilitating it. That equation is beginning to reverse now. And the insurer now tends to own the customer relationship and it's facilitated by a distributor. And that I think is very fundamental. Okay. So sum up, big changes will certainly happen. And I think companies will benefit from it and distribution will benefit from it as well.
What does all this mean from the customer perspective? Because every time a business becomes more efficient, I mean, suppose I take this point that digital is going to bring in greater level of efficiency, productivity, lower OPEX and all of that for this industry. Do those get redirected in terms of lower expense structure? Because as if you compare insurance products with, you know, several other financial products, the expense structure for intermediation in insurance is fairly high. So would it be reasonable to anticipate that over the next 3-5 years, we could see substantial cut in these costs?
So instead of giving you a forward-looking statement, let me just tell you that in the last 10 years, the pricing as far as protection policies are concerned has come down by almost 40% in the industry. Okay. The benefit that a customer gets in a unit-linked policy has improved by a multiple of 70% as compared to 10 years back, okay, in terms of the charge structures of the customer. So what's effectively happening is as the industry is becoming more competitive and it's becoming smarter, what's clearly happening is customers are getting the benefit of it. It's no secret that till as recently as 4 or 5 months back, the rates for protection in our country were the lowest in Asia. In fact, maybe we had overcorrected. As a result, there has been a little bit of an increase now in protection rates over the last couple of months, driven by the fact that, you know, the business had become just so competitive that it was beginning to make less sense both for the reinsurer and for the life insurers as well. So clearly, I think 23 companies out there competing, the benefits are already not trickling down, but going in a flood to customers.
Is that correct? But compared to other industries, would you not agree that disintermediation cost is fairly high for insurance? I mean, is there not a...
If I may just respond to this and then I'll request my colleagues to add to this. You know, I think given the fact that we have such a large number of intermediaries in insurance and it is a push-based sales category, I think we speak a lot about intermediation cost in insurance. But for various reasons, in other financial products, you know, since they are typically represented by employees in some cases and in some cases by a different think what ends up happening is the insurance industry gets needlessly vilified. End of the day, if you are looking at products which are comparable, and you know, you can make a comparison with, let's say, asset management, you can make a comparison with banking, I would certainly not say that costs of distribution are inflated in insurance at all. When you are doing business in a country as large as ours, and there is a significant capital which needs to be invested to be able to set up distribution across the country, then sure, someone has to pay for it, right? And that applies to every industry, not just life insurance. And you know, I'd love it to hear the views of everyone else on this call.
Absolutely. Vibha, would you expect a lower expense structure driven by productivity gains through digital?
Yes. Yeah, over a period of time, this has to start percolating, wherein it has to be a win-win for three parts in terms of key stakeholders, the company, its intermediaries, as well as the end customer. And that sharing will continue to evolve. And there will be newer products, perhaps, which are slightly more expensive. There could be more over-the-counter products that find and settle down in a sort of a mean, in a certain zone, and so on. And what will start happening, and I do hope that we are allowed to do a lot more and integrate a lot more of wellness in our products, like a Vitality, for example, or a Good Doctor, or a whole host of other examples, wherein if a customer can demonstrate to us that he has been taking these steps, so on his part, this is what he's been doing, that we can give a differential pricing down the line. So it's those sorts of things, rather than a static, and rather than today we are often going in blind because we don't have enough information about the individual. So it's this law of probabilities of very large numbers, and some cohort is subsidizing some other cohort, and you're hoping that you come out favorable in the whole over the years. But that will start becoming a lot more nuanced. So it's not just digital, meaning lesser number of people or lesser branches, which will then result in cost saving. That's a very tactical here and now. But what digital can do for us is digital with, like I mentioned earlier, big data, which will help us start getting a lot more nuanced, and hence for us to be able to do a lot more, lot sharper in terms of insights on pricing, which today, by the way, we can't do. So there's also a regulatory input that will help us propel. Today, we also can't integrate wellness, and we can't change the rate at which we have changed, unlike general insurers on health insurance policy, which can have a reset, or car insurance, which can have a reset, and so on. Life insurance can't have a reset. So you're underwriting at the time on best information at one particular point in time. That's it. His quality of life and his management of his life can significantly deteriorate or get better, and we have no control on that. So that pricing is also a function of the rigidity of the way in which we are able and allowed to price. If some of those constructs start changing, sure, we certainly would like to reward the guy who's taking care of his health better, or is in a lower health risk, or whatever other kind of risk that might be, or a better, more visibility on his KYC. Yes, certainly can see that evolving with some of these things coming together.
Sure. It's interesting, all of you also brought up this point about, you know, simpler products, given that we have all these digital tools and direct to customers with higher level of customer engagement and so on. Now, I'm wondering, why has it not been the case all along? For example, taking again a cue from the mutual fund industry, there was a time when, you know, everybody knows that NFOs was the way to gather assets. So anything is, that's the fashion of the day. Every asset management company would launch a fund in that theme, and then you collect assets, and then it becomes relevant when the market, you know, the fashion goes out of fashion. And there came a time when there was some level of consolidation driven by regulators saying that, hey, this is not working. You can't have like a plethora of funds, everybody overlapping and so on. And then the singular messaging that SIP is good for you kind of took off. And that's the stage when, you know, mutual funds really came alive and mass adoption happened. Somehow in insurance also, although the proposition that you need risk cover that term insurance is absolutely vital for each one of us. That singular messaging doesn't seem to have come through. One, why is that not the case? And second, are we really at that point from where this sort of this look, we look at this as an inflection point from where the trajectory really changes?
So I don't know, Malashvi, asking this question specifically. I just think we are at an inflection point. Shitish spoke about the push. I think after a long time, for the first time, I think there is some pull for life insurance thanks to COVID. I think both risk awareness and risk averseness both have gone up significantly. So I think from an awareness point of view, it can be a great fillip for the protection part of the business. And I think from an averseness point of view, there's also a plethora of savings products that insurance companies offer. Some of them are guaranteed and far better tax efficient over a long period of time. So we've seen some uptake in those areas. But your case for simplicity holds. I think we've got to do better in that area. But I genuinely think we are at an inflection point where, because of this risk awareness and averseness, that pull that we wanted in the life insurance business has just about started, and I think is there to stay for a reasonable point of time to come.
Sure. Let's just moving over to the second point, which I said that new reset is all about this lower interest rates. While it's good for businesses, from the saver's perspective, it's like, you know, you're really staring at very little in terms of guaranteed products. The rates are low, and risk assets, in most people's perception, can be argued that the valuations are high, but you can always justify saying that the interest rates are low, therefore the risk assets are priced as they are. But that leaves still a huge opportunity for investment-led products which offer healthy returns. But in terms of insurance, do we really have products that are competitive in terms of returns to give offer that magical experience to customers? And what kind of product development will we need to sort of fill in this gap? Because if you are looking at something that for 10 years or 15 years or 20 years, barring risk assets, I would only think of a provident employee provident fund or a voluntary provident fund, which gives you healthy returns.
So I'll take this question. From our the industry's point of view, it is really all sorts of products that we would like to offer to the customer. It's up to the customer's risk appetite. What is he looking to transfer? What kinds of risk is he looking to transfer to the insurer? In my mind, there are four types. There's mortality, there's morbidity, there's longevity, and the fourth is interest rate risk, which he can look to transfer, and it can be a combination of these. So to your point, yes, today we absolutely have products that are better than virtually any financial, I'm leaving PPF out, but any other competing financial services product post-tax. So also without reinvestment risk, because these you're looking at long tail guaranteed. So I'm not talking about the next 3, 4, 5 years, but I'm talking about when I'm 99 years old and so on. People who are today in say around 45, 47 age group, and perhaps are going to retire 10 years hence, are slowly, at least in the mass affluent segment, slowly becoming fairly aware that by the time they retire, interest rates are in all probability going to be low single digits. And also if you have a layer of inflation on top of it, which again, it doesn't look like it's going to go away in a hurry. Inflation adjusted returns are going to be a meaningless number. Correct. And also, you know, the senior citizens' favored product is bank fixed deposit. So putting all your eggs in that basket is also going to have a myriad of reinvestment risk, as well as, like I mentioned, post-inflation is really not going to cover one's medical expenses. So juxtapose that with the fact that most people who are today, say 55 and above, probably only have their medical insurance with their employer, the salaried people. So all of that, it becomes a cocktail of really disaster, wherein almost all of, first of all, they're not going to make very much by the time they're 15 years post-retirement. On top of it, most of it will go towards medical expenses and the hole that's there, and the fact that medical inflation is at least 2x normal inflation, if not 2.5x. So it's not just IRR in isolation, but what part of one's savings can one transfer to an insurer so that one can sleep slightly better at night? I think that starts becoming relevant. And so that category is emerging. Insurers, of course, need to manage risk in a manner that is sensible. More than just ALM matching, cash flow matches become extremely important in a long-dated liability profile. And the mistake of being saying I'm ALM match but not cash flow match also is quite suicidal for the company. So as long as risk managers within the company understand that there are hedges, effective hedges that are available, some of the product contours have make it possible for one to have natural hedges within your own company and so on, means that this product is certainly attractive. And coming back to your question, even today, significantly better, even in IRR terms, and I'm not even throwing in the fact that, which is often forgotten, that there's a mortality cover also. Even without the mortality cover being factored in, there are better IRRs.
How do you say that? Because there are two products which, in terms of guaranteed return, if you just unbundle and take a term policy and take a voluntary provident fund contribution, it's much superior return. And let's say that, you know, if you're not talking about people in the organized sector, even then you would have government products like the post office, which give you much better yield.
Not true post-tax. All of those are tax.
May I take this question?
Voluntary provident fund and employee provident fund, both are post-tax significantly higher. Of course, the government has to step in and say, well, this doesn't work. We can't take so much cash, and which has happened in the past. But barring that scenario, as long as the government is willing to support small savings,
the difference here is that if I stopped working today and I bought a policy, I would know the exact rupee value that I'm going to get till I'm 99. I don't think a voluntary provident fund gets me to that same answer. The voluntary provident fund I will get on the day, supposing if I'm 55 and I want to do something else in my life, I'll get that lump sum as a voluntary provident fund. What do I do? Where do I invest that money? I have to invest it into something. What will I do? I'll go and put maybe 50% of that in three different bank fixed deposits. I'll put something in mutual fund. I'm not going to get, if the objective is that I'm going to get the rupee value, and which cannot be changed by any insurer or anybody at all, no matter what, don't I want to buy some of it? I'm not saying buying all of it, but buying some of it so that I know this will pay for, if I'm in a rented accommodation, will pay for my rent, or it will pay for my society charges, or whatever, my medical expenses, whatever it might be. That is absolutely non-negotiable. I will get that amount. Please go ahead, Murli.
I think to view insurance like this is not the right way. The biggest thing insurance offers is sum assured. There is no product, PF, VPF, nobody can ever tell you that you pay me for number, say, 10,000 rupees a year. I will assure you, come what may, if India is in war with Pakistan or China, or there's a nuclear holocaust or this thing, I will pay you the sum of money. As long as you keep paying your premium every month, every year, whatever is it for. No PF, no VPF can offer. No, don't compare PF, which is subsidized. Let me just complete, then we will. So you can't, a PF which is part subsidized by the government is a different cup of tea. You can't compare that. Okay. So what insurance is about. As Vibha said earlier, one has to take a portfolio and say, what all I want to transfer to the insurance company? What are the risks I take on my books? So for example, I want to say that for my child's education or for my retirement, I need this sum of money. You don't want any ifs and buts in it. You want that money, come what may. And that is what insurance is. Insurance gives you that assurance that I'll give you the sum. Now, looking at investment products, actually today, ULIP is probably the best investment product. It can beat in front of cost structure all mutual funds. It is more tax efficient. The only thing it doesn't give in compared to a mutual fund is liquidity. But then you want tax efficiency.
But you have such high upfront load.
No, or look at all the Mahalakshmi, you are not at all. Today's go and see unit link products. There are products which have zero charge. Other than fund management charge, there are no charges. In added to that, you go and see the product. That has all changed. They all come down. Thanks to market forces, thanks to everything, this come down. If you, provided all these insurance products, they have one thing, they all have to be long term. And that is the reason they get the tax break. And the flexibility in unit link is such that I can actually, if the market is high today, I sell and put it into money market, it is tax free. Today's transition is tax free. There's no tax on it. Only when and on maturity. So there's a huge on the investment side also. So if you are looking for guarantee, as any individual looks for a guarantee, looks for wealth creation, that is insurance really offers you a fabulous deal. Now to say only protection is insurance, that is a very narrow view of insurance. Insurance is about living, it's about life. It is no.
Really,
it is
about, your company's name says that.
No, it is about life. No, it is about life. Life insurance, it's about life. I'm answering the term insurance. Insurance is about life. Either it is too short or it is too long. Okay, if it is too short, it is term insurance. If it is too long, it is long-term savings and annuity. It has to do both. And that is how insurance companies have constructed in India. Okay, so that is how LIC has run and that is how it is. So it is all about guarantees. To just take a product and say, short-term, a 10 or a 15-year product and compare the 20 or 25-year product, which guarantees you over a period of time, I don't think. And if you, let me answer that. PPF was 14% 10 years ago. It is 8% or 7%, 8%, I don't know the exact rate today. Half. They can reduce the rate every year. Can insurance company do it? It can't. And on top of it, if insurance companies' returns have to improve, the investment pattern has also to be changed. You can't have a rule that 50% you will put it in government securities where you will earn only 7%. 15% you will put in infrastructure where you will earn only 7% and then blame the insurance company you guys are not delivering. You can't do that. Either you, for the full freedom product, there is ULIP and there insurance companies are as good as mutual funds and as far as cost structure. And added to that, we have insurance.
Is there a need then to revisit from a regulatory perspective the investment universe? Because this whole 50%
investment is also
a legacy issue.
Because the 50% was done when SLR was 40%. SLR is now down to 25%. That has not come down. But I think it's not a topic which can be
proved. Right.
It has a much deeper topic because it's a question of security. It's a question of such a long-term period. So in an insurance company, it's also good. 50% is the sovereign. So there are also other implications for it. So I think it has to be very carefully done. And unit link is anyway offering you an opportunity to diversify if you want, right? And it is completely transparent. Every charge is shown to you.
Sure.
So I hope I have answered. I hope all the panelists agree with me on this.
Absolutely. I can speak on their behalf.
So, Murli has made a very spirited defense for the industry.
I have to. I spent a lifetime here, so I better defend the industry. I believe it.
By the end of this discussion, I may also agree.
By the end of the discussion, you will buy a product from us. You just watch.
Yeah, and I think we would have failed in our duty if you don't agree.
So, to wrap it up, over the next 3 years to 5 years, what are the three big changes that you expect to see, both in terms of products and the way the industry has shaped up?
So I'll go first. Yeah. I expect to see a lot more of risk transfer products. So there will be two parts to this. There will be the savings-led insurance of older people. Younger people will start engaging with and having discussions openly on dying, falling sick, what-if scenarios, which perhaps their fathers and older relatives might not have been happy doing. So that transfer, that very significant change in behavior patterns will happen. There will be a larger chunk, like we spoke at the beginning, of how do we give a more transparent product, transparent process. The customer feels that he is in control. Today he pays for everything, but he might say, okay, this feature I might never use. It's not relevant to me at all, because it talks about something that if that were to happen to your mortgage, for example. I don't have a house. So unbundling even of our traditional product will start happening, wherein he feels, I want more of this, less of this. So he's almost constructing, build your own product, that sort of thing. Today, that's not possible, but can it happen? I've seen it in some of the studies that we've seen in other geographies. So he can have more control over what he buys. That will certainly happen. This entire part on, like I said, health, wellness, and those lines blurring for us to be able to do dynamic underwriting by, if he agrees to show us his credit cards statements, for us to have those algorithms to say, okay, this is what we think is the profile of this individual, without asking him any question on his about his own declaration on health status. So that kind of evolution is something I see happening. Also on the bottom of the pyramid, today the question is that how do we tap the bottom of the pyramid, because the cost of acquisition is prohibitive for us to set up shop in smaller locations. Ticket sizes are small. Disclosures are abysmally low in terms of their health records, their KYC, probably non-existent. But is the need there? Certainly. Are they in reasonably good health? Perhaps, especially on the younger population. So how are we able to close the gap on the unbanked and also the middle, the non-metros? Because the metro population is perhaps overwooed by everybody. So how do we see that opportunity and are able to have a win-win in that opportunity as well? And that will happen the way mutual funds also, wherein it's a non-face-to-face, simpler products, underwriting becoming simpler, all of that. So that opportunity is certainly there. So I see all of this coming together as both a combination of digital data that we can use, Shitin, or somebody, I think Kamlesh mentioned IIB, other modes of how we can enrich our data, get a good sense of the customer, regulations. As that happens, that's the evolution that I see happen.
Sure.
I think the speed at which insurance industry has moved in the last, I think I can see three phases already in the insurance industry, has already happened. One before the initial stages, and then the price changes, and again the last after the companies got listed. I think the changes in the next 3 years are going to be much faster. I think that the changes will happen because by one, competitive practices, because if you really see the disclosures and competition practices are actually making more and better products, which are having lower and lower costs carrying. Just in the case of unit link, as I told you, there are products which are just fund management charges. They return the mortality charge at the end. So products have come in, and I think more and more people are coming with such products. And the industry will also learn to go to the rest of the segments, because it is just a SEC and above product, which can actually now, because of technology, because of knowledge and our ability, because we may not need so many offices, we may not need so much of infrastructure. So it will be possible for us to go really to that segment of the society as bottom of the pyramid, not really the full bottom, probably middle of the pyramid. Somewhere technology will make it possible for us to do. And that, I think, will open up a huge opportunity. And I think combination of media regulatory action will force the prices down. So I think these are changes that are going to happen.
Murli, you talked about simplicity. So do you see a significant shift in your the product portfolio or contribution from various genre of products in your portfolio over the next 3 to 5 years?
See, in my view, traditional products are simple. Okay. Actually, in insurance industry, there are a lot of noises being made about complex products. There are actually only three products. There is an endowment.
Industry has made it complicated.
Endowment is just endowment, term, and unit link. Okay, and of course, now annuity. But annuity and all are important because it's a great hedge. It's a very great hedge for protection products, both on the mortality side And even annuity is a great hedge for guaranteed products because they provide a single premium guarantee at that time. So there's a they're very important. They all run together. Otherwise, it's a very natural hedge for the industry. So I think the products will get simple and people will also understand. I think both will bet. We will also improve our communication to them and their understanding will also improve on this. So I think over a period of time, people are going to understand the importance of sum assured and that you are paying a return on the sum insured on the day one when you have paid only a small premium. So these are all concepts which are very unique to insurance, but people will learn. I think both will happen. Simplicity.
So allow me to add to what Murali said. There are three major stakeholders here. The first most important, the customer. I think something which I see which has already started changing now is that the customer today is far more literate and understands his own needs much better than she did 10 years or 15 years back when the private sector was relatively immature. Okay. So my belief is that the biggest change that we are going to see is a bulk of the policies that we are going to be selling. We are going to be selling to customers who are aware, A, about their needs, B, about whether the solution works for them. You know, this whole concept of research online, buy offline. I find now in tier 2, tier 3 markets, most of our sales are happening to customers who have gone and read about the organization, read about how it compares with other companies and so on and so forth. So first, I think the big change that you will see is that customer ignorance is not going to be an underlying theme, which is what our industry did not do a very good job of 15 or 20 years back. So that's the first. The second, I mentioned some time back that distribution is going to change fundamentally aided by technology. And distributors are going to facilitate relationship that companies have directly with customers, as opposed to the fact which in the past used to be that the distributor used to own the relationship and the company used to underwrite it with the product. That's the second part, right? Third, I completely agree with Murali that eventually we have added too much complexity to life insurance, at least as far as perception is concerned. It is not really such a complicated industry. The fact, however, and the reason why I suspect intermediation will be required for some time to come, we are the only industry which is looking at 10, 20, 30, 40 years ahead. And this is something that most customers need help to be able to think through. Okay. So, the only complexity here is we are talking about a very distant future, an uncertain future. And to that extent, the complexity which comes with the fact that there will be changes in life expectancy, there will be changes in health, there will be changes in medicine, there will, be changes in interest rates, as you pointed out. That's, I think, the only complexity. And we as an industry are very well placed to be able to manage it, especially through the traditional products which offer either a complete or a partial guarantee to customers via the sum assured that Murali spoke about. So, my belief is this is a good time for the industry. And in fact, two great things have happened. Number one, in the last couple of months, we are back to roaring growth as an industry. Two is, we've been speaking about digital for some time. Just today, hot off the press, 12th of November, the regulator has allowed the industry to be able to source policies without a wet signature from a customer. So we truly are going to be now digitally enabled, where you will be able to conclude an entire insurance transaction without necessarily having to have a face-to-face interaction, which I think is a fundamental change. And this is going to completely change the way business is going to be done going forward. So that was my contribution.
Sure. Kamlesh, the radical change.
So my chance to go. I'm going to tell you what I wish will change over the next 3 or 4 years time. I wish that in the next 3 or 4 years time, insurance no longer remains a push sale. But when I'm going to say a Kshitij or a Vibha, I know exact so much details about them that I know what I should sell to them, which product should be sold to him, and definitely a digital journey that will allow me to close the transaction in one or two clicks. I'm hoping that the ease of the sale for the customer will be appropriate. I think the big change that can happen is if the other part of the underwriting is there's a way where all of us who are getting into regular checkups and which is available with the diagnostic centers and with the new health ID coming in, is there a way all that data can be stored in the cloud and I can just pluck it from there rather than actually asking my guy to do a medical checkup when he's buying a policy? So if the whole technology world can change that in medical, but I'm able to actually import data on the fly and I'm able to match and say exactly this is what is meant for this guy. So I think that can change, because that can change the other dynamics of the life insurance business. And the third thing I think, which I'm very sure will change, is the large owners of data, which today is the large ecosystems like the Amazons of the world and so on and so forth, who know so much about their customers. If there is a way for the manufacturing industry like life insurance to create products with the wealth of information that the Facebooks and the Googles and the ecosystem like Amazon have, I think there could be a marriage between the two for distribution. And I think that will take center stage at some point in time.
That's a very dangerous territory. Supremely dangerous.
No, but they will never be manufacturers, I hope. They'll be distributors of the products, and with the information that they have and the marriage of the manufacturer products, I think that can significantly increase the penetration of insurance that we have in the country. I think that's what can be one big change of the ecosystem, is what my view.
Sure. So thank you so much, gentlemen. I've taken a lot of your time. The 1 hour slot is over. Thank you for sharing all your insights and, of course, for your time.
Thank you, Mahalakshmi.
Thank you, Mahalakshmi, and happy Diwali to you and all the panel.
To all of you, too. Thank you.
Thank you, and happy Diwali to all of you.